The scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, with the first 11 verses. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds went ahead of him, and that followed with their shouting, "Hosanna, son of David, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, be with us this day. May we hear your word, and may we have the strength to put your word into practice, now and always. Amen. Palm Sunday marks the beginning of the last week of Jesus' life. It is only in this last week that we can follow Jesus from day to day. On Sunday, he rode into Jerusalem and he was praised and treated as a king. On Monday, he cleansed the temple, throwing out the thieves and the money changers. On Tuesday, he spent time in debate and controversy with answering people's questions not seeking guidance, but questions that were set up to trap him. Wednesday, he was shown an outpouring of love when a young woman washed his feet and then dried them with her hair and anointed them in oil. While this woman was showing her love to Jesus, Judas, one of his loyal disciples, was taking steps to betray him. Thursday, Jesus was able to have a last meal with his disciples, and out of that meal has come to the Christian church that sacrament, which is the central act of the church's worship. And on Thursday, he was then arrested, and that began the ordeal of Jesus' betrayal and denial, trial, crucifixion, and resurrection. Now, Jesus knew these things were going to happen. He stressed about it, he prayed about it, and he trusted God to see him through it. During his last week on earth, Jesus took care of business by clearing the temple. He debated and argued about God's love with those who were trying to trap him. He spent time with people he loved. He created lasting traditions, and he went through a trial and did not put up a fight as he was falsely accused. I don't know about you, but my last week on earth, if I knew it was coming, and sometimes I feel like I do, my last week on earth would be different. I would be traveling to every restaurant, every movie theater, and every amusement park between here and Orlando. I would be eating every piece of chocolate and diabetic forbidden food that I could get my hands on. And I would be taking advantage of every piece of unused data on my phone, and I would rent a ton of library books. But look at what Jesus did. This was a very important, this was a crucial week, and one that surely put him to the test. And he lived it as if it was any other week. He continued to teach and to love and to serve life as God's example. This demonstration gives yet another illustration of how loving, how wonderful Jesus our Lord is. Now, between today and next Sunday, we are going to travel with Christ on his last days to see how those events give our lives meaning and purpose. So today we focus on Palm Sunday. So let's look at the classic tale and let's see what we can learn today. In Jerusalem, it was Passover time, which meant the city would have been full to capacity. Now here is some information I got from William Barclay's commentary. This is what he says. Every Passover lamb had to be slain and the blood of it sacrificed in the temple courts. The minimum that each lamb was to serve was 10 people. So in order to get an accurate count of the number that attended the Passover, the priest would simply count the number of slain lambs. The number of lambs during this particular Passover was 256,500. So it was estimated that there were over 2.5 million people in the city at the time of Passover. It was into a city that was that crowded that Jesus came. He came at a time when the crowds and the religious fervor were the most intense. Add to that the fact that the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, they should let them know so that he might be arrested. Now, again, if that had been me, I would have kept a very low profile until the heat died down. If I had to go to Passover, I would have worn, you know, those Groucho glasses with the big bushy eyebrows and the mustache. That's how I would have shown up at the Passover. Jesus, however, decided to enter into Jerusalem in a manner that had every eye focused upon his every move. He didn't stay away. He didn't hide from the authorities. He deliberately did what had to be done. In many ways, Jesus' act on Palm Sunday was an act of courage. Jesus got a hold of a donkey and he rode it into the waiting arms of his enemies. There is courage that is revealed when a person acts on the spur of the moment, when an emergency or a crisis occurs and one must act quickly with no time to think, pulling someone out of a building when there's a fire, defending someone who is being bullied or picked on. But there is a higher form of courage when a person has the time and clarity of thought to think of their situation. It is one thing to be courageous with instinctive reaction. It's another thing to know what lies ahead, to weigh the options, and to deliberately decide to press on. That is the kind of courage that Jesus displayed in Jerusalem. That's courage. Second, on that first Palm Sunday, Jesus displayed a wonderful act of love. When he rode into Jerusalem, he did something that was common practice among Israel's prophets. An effective tool that the prophets used to use was to do something that had symbolic action. To drive a prophet home, a prophet would use dramatic presentation. In order to have people understand their message, they would put it into some vivid form. So the question is, what was the message? What point was Jesus trying to convey? God's people had wanted a warrior. They had come to believe that God's Messiah would be this great warrior. On that day, the Messiah would come and he would destroy all the nation's enemies. A king that would wipe out all adversaries so that the Jewish people would be strong and mighty. Jesus, by entering the city on a donkey, was making a different claim. In Zechariah, it says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter, shout aloud, O daughter, your king comes to you, triumphant, humble, and riding on a donkey." In the East, during the time of Jesus, the donkey was a noble beast. When a king entered a city, ready to do battle, he would come into the city on a horse. But when a king came in peace, he would ride on a donkey. Jesus entered Jerusalem in this way. He entered the city showing that he was the Messiah, but not this warrior Messiah they were expecting. He was showing them that he was a Messiah of peace. He was a Messiah that would rule in their hearts, a Messiah who would run his kingdom not with force, but with love. It was as if Jesus was saying, "Look, look, look, you wanted a king? Here I am. Open your hearts and let me in. I have come to you on this donkey to show you how much I love you. To show you that God was not a warring, vindictive, had to be appeased at all costs God. Jesus was trying here to make a last appeal to convey that this coming in a donkey was an act of peace from a loving God. Jesus on Palm Sunday showed us an act of love. And the third thing we learned today is that Jesus had someone help him. If we go back to verses 2 and 3, go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied up and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say, the Lord needs them, and you will go immediately. Jesus had some prearranged signal, something worked out with someone in advance to borrow this donkey for his historic ride. Everything was prearranged, and this owner of the donkey, this man in the town, was all set up to help Jesus and what he had to do. And if you think about it, this is a wonderful thing. As hard as this week was for him, as difficult as it was going to get, he had someone standing by ready to help, ready to give him anything that he needed. And if you look back into Scripture, Jesus asked a lot of people for help. The New Testament is full of examples of how Jesus constantly needed people to do his work. Turned away from the door of an inn while he was still in his mother's womb, he needed someone to give him a stable to be born. When he needed a pulpit in which to preach to the masses, someone let him borrow a boat so that he could do that. Filled with compassion for a hungry crowd, someone helped him by donating their lunch so that he could perform a miracle and feed over 5,000 people. On the Thursday of Holy Week, he needed a room in order to have his Last Supper with his disciples. When he was carrying his cross and could go not another step, he needed a man named Simon to carry it for him. And at the end of his life, when his body needed a final resting place, it was laid in a borrowed tomb. Jesus, who is a great friend to us, is also a friend in need. On that first Palm Sunday, Jesus does three important acts. He did not hide from trouble, he courageously faced it head on. He showed us his love as our Messiah of peace. And he showed us that he needed people to be his friend and to help him. I think this story is a great story. And on that first Palm Sunday, Jesus triumphantly rode into Jerusalem, showing courage and love and that he was needed. But what does it do for us? We don't have parades with donkeys anymore. They don't mean what it meant in Jesus' time. Today in the life of the church is a huge service of celebration. So what does Palm Sunday do for us? Well, let's look at the three acts again. First, we see that Jesus was courageous. Yep. First, we see that Jesus was courageous and that he didn't hide from those that were trying to do him harm. That's the kind of courage we need. A courage that's not afraid to do what's right. A courage that's not afraid to face what's before us. A courage that takes on our enemies and those that would do us harm. And when we have that courage of Christ, we have nothing to fear because Christ is with us and knows exactly what we're going through because he had this courageous act that he can show us that he did. And also, because it says that he didn't hide from his enemies, that tells me that Jesus never hides from us. He's always right there. We don't have to leave him a message. We don't have to go looking for him. We don't have to have him call us back at another time. He is always right there. He never hides. And because he never hides from us, that can give us the courage to live life and do what we need to do. Second, on Palm Sunday, this was an act of love. I think it's very hard for people to believe in Jesus, to believe in God today, because we have to do a lot of it in faith. It's hard to see a loving God sometimes when we don't have the kind of relationship that we have with other people that we love. We can't sit and have a cup of coffee with Jesus. We can't run to him and have him hold us in times of need. We can't do the loving things with Jesus in a loving relationship that we do with other people. And so I think sometimes it's hard for us to see that love. And because we don't have the normal relationship that we have with others, when things go bad, our natural reaction is to say, how could a good and loving God let this happen? But it doesn't take much to keep our eyes open and see the love of Christ all around us, in the beauty of creation, in the preciousness and the innocence of our children, in the presence and the listening ear of a friend, in the blessings of our family, in the crucifixion. In times of trouble, it's not hard to see the love of Christ. Fred Rogers, who I didn't watch until I was an adult, because in seminary I got three channels, and when I came home in the afternoon and I wanted to relax, I put on Mr. Rogers, because he graduated from Pittsburgh Seminary, as I did. But Fred Rogers used to always say, when there's times of crisis and trouble, look for God's helpers. That when crisis occurs, you will always find people that will run to your aid. That's the love of Christ. That's Christ's love with us all the time. That's what we learn from today. The third thing is just as Jesus needed help securing this historic ride into Jerusalem, he needs our help. Every single day. We are his witnesses in this world. We are his advocates to this world. We are his servants in the world. He lives and exists and can do the things because he calls us to do them in this world. We are Jesus' feet and hands and voice. And the way I look at it is, Jesus, you are born and you are put together in such a special way. All your talents and looks and skills and everything that makes you you, God has put together to serve his purpose. That's what Jesus Christ wants us to show to the world. That's how we help him. Those are the three things that we can do in this world that we can gain from this Palm Sunday table. Now, my story to end today, keeping on track, it's a story from a book called Hot Illustrations or More Hot Illustrations. It's a compilation. I used to have it on CD. I now just have the books. But it's a compilation of stories that a man named Wayne Rice put together that was used for youth groups and to get conversations and camps and things going. And most of my stories, not all, but most of my stories are coming from these books. And I'm going to run out in about 3 years at the rate that I'm going. But this is where this I don't want to say the same quote every single week that I'm using the same book every single week for my illustrations. But it's always printed in my sermon, so you can see it. This story today, this may be a two-tissue story. You may have to get ready. It's got a good ending, but you may have to get ready because it's a story about a young girl who lived with her parents, and tragically, her parents died in a car crash. And so she was shipped off to the grandmother. And she was living with her grandmother, and again, tragically, one night, there's a fire in the house. And the girl is trapped upstairs, and the grandmother can't get to her. In fact, the grandmother perishes trying to get the girl to safety. And the neighbors show up and people are trying to help. They can hear the girl screaming from upstairs in the bedroom, but every single door, every single window is blocked by flames. And there's nothing anyone can do. And this is before the fire department has even arrived. So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, there appears a man. And he takes a ladder, he puts it next to the house, he climbs up, he goes right through the flames of the open window, disappears behind the smoke, comes back a couple minutes later with the girl wrapped up in a blanket, comes back through the open flames, climbs down and gives her over to the paramedics, and then disappears. Just all of a sudden, he's not there. And life goes on. The girl is taken to the hospital, she is checked out, she is released, and a couple of months later, she is recovering very nicely from any physical wounds from the fire, but she's in court because they're still dealing with all the emotional wounds of the fire. The parents are gone, the grandmother's gone. There's a judge that's trying to decide where to put this young girl. Fortunately, there's lots of people that want to adopt her and take her in. And so the judge is meeting with them to decide who is the best person to place with this little girl who's been through so much in her life already. Well, the first person that wants her is her teacher. And she says, I am a teacher. I know how to teach children. I know how to motivate them. I know what they're up to. I know how to punish them if needed to. And I know this little girl personally. She would be a wonderful addition to living in my house. Next, there's a farmer. And he says, I was friends with the parents, and I would be happy to have this girl. She would come with me. She would have a simple life, but a very good and rewarding life. She would learn the responsibilities of hard work. She would learn how to care and nurture for animals in this world. And she would have a good, honest existence, and I would be happy to take her. Again, there's a lady that stands up and she says, I lived on the next street over from this family and I know them well, and she can come and live with me. I am loaded and there is nothing that I can't provide for this girl. She would have everything her heart desires and she would never want for anything. And from this point on, she would have a wonderful life. And so the judge has to assess all this and make his decision, and which one does she go to? And he says, before I make my decision, is there anyone else that wants to say anything? And just then, a man comes from the back. And you all know who this man is, it's not a surprise. The man comes from the back, and he comes up, and he faces the girl and the audience in the courtroom, and he holds up his hands, and you can see all the scars on his hands and his forearms and his underarms from the fire. And when he holds up his hands, the little girl smiles from ear to ear and said, that's the man who saved me. And she jumps into his arms and she buries her head in his shoulder. And the judge looks around and he says, this case is adjourned. And he bangs his gavel. That man displayed courage, that man displayed love, and that man showed that both him and that little girl needed each other. Jesus does exactly the same for us. Same thing, we can see all the scars, we can see all the marks, we can see everything he's done for us to show us that act of courage, to show us that tremendous love. And because we're here, and because he was resurrected from the cross, he shows us every day that we need each other. Well, let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. Help us to do for you this day all that we can to show your love and courage to this world. Amen.